There's the man.
Hey there, how you doing?
Well, the people that had a lot of questions for you that I knew of have not arrived yet, so you just talk about whatever you want to talk about, and we'll actually look at questions. Good evening. I'd like to thank y'all all for coming to our November meeting. And we're delighted to have a guest speaker this evening, and it's Commissioner Patrick Bell. He was originally scheduled to come back in August, and we had to change his plans and ask if he could come back. So we said certainly, and this was the next time that we could have a convenient schedule that would match. So if you all give a round of applause.
Well, thank you for having me. That's okay.
That's all.
I'm glad to be here. First thing I want to tell you is I recognize, although I ran on the Republican ticket, that you're still citizens here. I represent everybody in the county. We run district-wide. I tell people a lot of times, I'm not a district commissioner, I'm a county commissioner. And I'm not necessarily a Republican county commissioner, I'm a county commissioner. I represent everybody in the county. Trying to think of some things to talk to you guys about tonight. It's pretty quiet right now in county government. As you know, we've adopted our budget for the year. We were able to adopt a millage rate and a net increase. SQOST just passed, clearly. We'll start on some of those programs soon. So really what I'd like to do is let you guys just ask some questions. I joke a lot. One of the worst things I have to do is go listen to other politicians talk sometimes. Y'all really don't want to listen to me drone on. You've got things on your mind that are of interest to you. And so I'll open it up to just some questions if you would like to start with that.
Commissioner, I'm John Hamilton.
Yeah.
I reside in District 4.
Yeah.
The fact that SQOST passed, and I believe in most of the counties where SQOST was on the ballot, it did pass. And with the anti-tax rhetoric that's so prevalent today, what is your takeaway of the fact that on the local level, voters are still willing to keep taxes going to pay for infrastructure and roads and things like that?
I believe that Forsyth County citizens, no matter if they're from what party, they do believe in investing in the community. I will say that I believe that this particular SPLOST was kind of an eye-opener. It was for me anyway, with the very slim margin that it passed. When we originally were working on the projects, you know, we recognized that it needed to be a necessary project SPLOST. Not a whole lot of park and rec, libraries, senior center. We know we need that, but I think right now people are more interested in transportation. The jail and the courthouse is a necessity that we just can't get around. So we tried to keep that to a minimum. But I believe that people do still believe that they want to invest in their community. I think that the board, I can't say the board, but I think that the overall process missed the mark on quite a few points as far as getting some additional citizen input, looking at different projects. I think we probably could have done a better job at that.
So where do we stand with the county jail right now? Is that being addressed by the SQOST?
Absolutely, it'll be addressed. We're going to get started on it soon. I don't know when. We've not had any meetings to discuss that yet. The intent was to borrow enough money to get started and then work on when the SQOST revenue comes in and starts overlapping, kind of like when you see your mortgage go from interest and principal, that shift. We want to do just the basics to continue to get it going right now, and hopefully it'll catch up. It'll be one of the first things that the revenue goes towards when it starts coming in 2013. The ballot said that we could bond up to $89 million. I have no intention of borrowing $89 million. We have been approached by, can't tell you how many people. All the banks have, you know, started emailing and sending in proposals. And with the banks having more cash on hand today than they've ever had, we can borrow money. I think one of the proposals, it was sub 1%, the rate. Well, they've got the money. They can't loan it to anybody else. Government's pretty sure thing, I guess, on to their risk ratios. Some have proposed line of credit type things. It's really unique, things banks have never done before. It used to be bonds. The governments, municipalities sold bonds. We got banks wanting to make just straight loans. So it's an interesting concept, but we only intend on borrowing enough money to get started.
Will this be big enough to have extra people, like right now, Forsyth County send their people to Hall County or whatever?
We do. There was some information.
And that's a moneymaker too, isn't it?
Well, it's a moneymaker for Hall County.
Yeah.
It's not for us. We're not going to get in the jail business.
Okay.
I don't, I say that. Could change, but there's no intent of going into the jail business right now. There's been some discussion about the jail that we're proposing will be at capacity by 2023. I don't know where that date came from. There were some calculations made, but the expansion that will be added on later as we need it can address those needs. So we can go further than 2023. It just depends on how it's constructed, those expansions.
The sheriff said one of the problems with the jail was the courts because they're so slow.
Well, it's kind of a catch-22. We arrest people, we put them into jail, we're trying to get them through the court system so that they can either go free or go back to jail, and it's just completely bottlenecked. Okay. I was talking to a deputy the other day. There was a drug investigation going on, that's all I guess you'd call it. A little bit higher level. It wasn't people that sell small amounts. They would not cross the county line. They made the people meet them in Fulton County. They would not come into Forsyth County. And one of the reasons being is our courts, our sheriff's office is known to make arrests. Our courts are known to put people in jail. They don't plea bargain with people. In Fulton County, they plea bargain. We don't do that. We put them in jail. So, it's a whole lot of one relies on the other to be an effective system. Number one, to protect people's rights, get them out of jail. If they're not supposed to be there, we need to get them out of there. We need to get them through the courts and get them out or lock them up for doing wrong.
For so long, we have the city and the county, and there's such an overlap on really services. Is there any talk of combining the police and the sheriff's department ever again? Because, it's a nightmare, right? Live in the county. My husband had a business. We had to file a complaint against somebody, and it was like the city wouldn't handle this kind of an arrest. Only the county would handle certain kinds of things, but it was in the city limits, and just doesn't make sense. You've got such a small population in the city. The city has excess money. It doesn't have the facilities. It doesn't have the court system that's needed for certain
Well, as far as that goes, we don't have any authority, is the best way to put it, with city and what the state law and the Constitution allows them to have as far as a police department. The sheriff's lobby, on the other hand, is probably one of the strongest, if not the strongest, lobby in the state of Georgia. Don't know why, they just are. There's 159 sheriffs, and they're absolutely the strongest. So
I know Wesley Walraven was at one time president of that organization.
Yeah, so. And I don't know if our sheriff has been president of it or not. He may have been.
Wesley was our sheriff.
Yeah. So, but I don't see that. I don't see there being a county police force. The county can have a police force versus a sheriff, but it's a referendum issue that the voters have to vote on, and
when you get to certain technical, and it was civil versus criminal issues, and it's a nightmare. And there just seems to, of course it goes back to the old problems of the city getting along with the county and the power issues and what goes on, and that's been a problem for years.
Mm-hmm.
But, it just seems like if there could be more effective rhetoric that the people in the city and the county would be better served if there was one system.
Well, yeah, but that's not something we can control. I know what you're saying, but that's from a constitutional level. When in the 80s, when the Constitution was adopted, municipalities were given certain rights. So it'd be tough to change it.
I think they have to be willing to give up that right.
They have to be willing to give up, and you have to have legislators that are willing to take it up as well.
I'm concerned about our workforce and employment here in the county.
Absolutely.
The construction people that start working on the courthouse and the jail, is there any way that we could make that a contractual obligation to hire subcontractors or a percent of the people or something to where we get jobs in the county?
Absolutely. I don't know the specifics of it. We're looking into that now as far as what we can require as far as government through the bid process. I could be speaking for every commissioner that we want to see most of the jobs go to Forsyth County residents. We've got a lot of people to work. Our unemployment rate's still lower than the rest of the state, but it's higher than it should be. So that's one of the things I work on. I'll tell you, I fight that all the time. I kind of get a bad rap for it sometimes. I look at it as property rights and economic development and trying to get companies to come here and hire people. And, you know, we get hung up a lot with the neighborhood groups that don't want something down the street from them, things like that. But I fight every day to bring companies here. I call national headquarters of companies. I've talked to the senior vice president of Walmart Corporation. I called Bentonville. Talked to them about their neighborhood markets, the grocery stores that they're building. I mean, I do a lot of work with them.
So. And weren't they planning a Walmart up on next, or what, 369?
They were at one time at 369 and 400, mm-hmm. but and I wasn't on the board at that time, but I believe the Riverkeeper filed a protest that stopped it from coming.
The what?
The Upper Chattahoochee Riverkeeper. They're the same group that has fought us on our wastewater discharge. We're now at about $550,000 in legal fees. Yes.
Well, first of all, I want to compliment the Board of Commissioners on your financial situation. looks like y'all have done a real nice job of keeping the county financially secure with your rating, and I think y'all have what, $25 million or something in your reserve fund, and I'd like to compliment you as part of the commission, and the whole commission is running a ship that's seems to try to take that pretty seriously. One thing that I would like to ask is, being from the 4th District up there, and me being on the Planning Commission, I've never really given it a whole lot of thought up until the last Planning Commission meeting about what the people in the 4th District really want. I've heard different things, you know. I kind of come away from talking with them that they want one thing now, but in the future they want something different, you know, as far as the land and the zoning and stuff. And I'm interested in trying to help, you know. I'd like to see the 4th District prosper if that's what they want to do, but if they want to just protect their land, I'd like to see them do that too. I think there's...
Are you referring to like the future what? Development map and the character area map, that process?
Some of that stuff, yeah.
I believe that just on that, you know, you say that if they want to profit from their land, allow them to do that or protect their land to help them do that. Does that mean protect it from development or...
Well, you know, of course, I've been around here a long time, and I remember the old days, and of course, this isn't the old days anymore, but I remember that the people wanted to stop everything, in particular up north. We don't want anybody, these interlopers coming into Forsyth County. And frankly, that was the last impression I had from the 4th District. But now I'm getting the feeling that the people in the 4th District would like to open it up so that their kids could sell some of their property later on. But in the meantime, we want to leave it like it is. Well, because we like, so, and I, so I'm kind of torn. I don't know, I mean, you represent the district, and I'm trying to get some help from you on, how should I approach this?
Well, from that aspect, you've been here through several phases of growth in the county.
Mm-hmm.
As far as, you know, stop, we don't want anybody up here. I wasn't here for that phase,
yeah. So
I couldn't even begin to address it. What I will tell you is, I believe that the people that own property, whether it be 1 acre, or 100 acres, or in one case, 1,300 acres, is they want to be able to develop their property as the market dictates. If that means they are building third acre lots with 1,800 square foot houses, and that's what the market is dictating, that's what they want to do. Mm-hmm. If the market's dictating 5 acre lots with 5,000 square foot homes, mm-hmm. that's what they want to do. They want the freedom to do what they want to do with their property.
Now, is that what most of the people want to do, or is that just what the big landowners? If you start building some of that up there, and you got a guy over here that owns like 5 acres, what do those people?
Generalities, all right, not big landowners, not mm-hmm. small. I think in generalities, I think the consensus is people don't want to be told what they can do with their land.
Okay.
Period. They don't want their neighbor to tell them what to do with it. Now, I will say that's a District 4 philosophy that's a little bit different than the District 3's. District 3's not quite as bad. District 2 is bad. The south end of District 5.
But that's why we have zoning.
That is why
we have zoning. You know, because some people don't care about their neighbors.
That's right.
And they're going to put up...
I'm just telling you what the people feel. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm just saying that I believe that the
overall feeling is... Yeah, I'm trying to figure out how to... to get to that point, you know, because to try to make the 4th District have most of the other districts are different.
District 4 does not want the estate residential, which is the large lots, mm-hmm. the pastoral views, and all that. They feel, the large landowners feel, that that's penalizing them.
That what?
Penalizes them.
Yeah, because it would keep the big developers from keep coming in and even looking at the property.
Now,
they'd like to come look, but not necessarily buy. Right
part now. Of what we're learning now, and it's kind of an interesting concept, that this density issue that this county's been hung up on for 10 years is really contrary to proper planning. You know, low density causes sprawl. A little higher density keeps things locked together. We're finding now, when I've gone through planning classes at the University of Georgia and down at Tifton at the Abraham Baldwin Agricultural Center, is more tight-knit community type areas. You'll find on the future land use map now, the new one has communities put back on it. You know, the little circles, and it says Ducktown and Matt, Call Mountain. Mm-hmm. I put those back on there, ask for those to be put on there. Because people, number one, are looking for a sense of place. You know, they don't want to be from mm-hmm. out there in Forsyth County. They want to be from Call Mountain, Ducktown, mm-hmm. Shake Rag, whatever the different areas are. Also with town centers, where they can do their business right there close to home. Doesn't mean that we need a super Walmart in every area, but it means that we need some retail in these areas where before we didn't allow it. And then the low density movement that's gone on for the last decade has created a lot of sprawl.
Mm-hmm.
It's contrary to what people want.
The Planning Commission to maybe work on trying to get the 4th District to grow more, or do you want us to?
I want the market and the property owners to dictate what happens in district. I don't want the Planning Commission to dictate it, and I certainly don't want to dictate uh-huh. it. I have to make sure.
That's why I put my question like it is. Do you want us to help you? What direction?
I don't think right now we got to worry with it. We're in such a unique time that we can't begin to.
The other thing, speaking of classes, the ones I've been to and stuff, learned about income off of the undeveloped property. You actually get a better return, the county does, on undeveloped property than they do on developed property. And that may be one of the reasons that they're contributing to the good financial condition that the county finds itself in, is we have some undeveloped property in the northern part, and that's bringing in...
I wouldn't say that, because undeveloped property does bring in tax revenue with no associated services, per se. No school.
Yeah, on balance, it comes out better.
There could be fire and police, but very little.
Poorly developed property costs the county tons of money.
Costs a lot of money.
Just go down Highway 9, and look at all these 10,000 square foot shopping centers.
And that's exactly what...
That's what we don't want, because it looks like somebody just threw up commercial development.
There's a lot of things, you know.
But that's why I'm talking about the undeveloped.
Of the planning commission, what is their job? And I don't know if anybody wants to, you know, hear all the litany of what I think the planning commission is, but I will tell you, I think that this county has done a poor job of planning, whether it be just in planning altogether. You know, we have some that want to be a bedroom community with no retail. We want some that, you know, I prefer, and I think that the best thing long-term for our community is to be a whole community, which means we have affordable housing to multi-million dollar housing. We have jobs that are $8 an hour. We have jobs that are $80 an hour or $800 an hour, surgeons and things of that nature. With that comes apartments. Now, we have people that don't want apartments in Forsyth County. But if we're going to be a whole community, we've got to have housing for everybody.
Yeah, I agree. I think that the planning in the county has not been real good. Now, my take on that at this point is that in the past, the planning board has
found
a special interest.
It's a zoning board. We don't have a planning commission. We got a zoning commission.
Yeah.
You guys are not planning anything, and I don't mean that in a bad way.
Yeah.
No, but what I'm saying is you don't really long term.
What I'm saying is the reason that some of this has happened is, from being there for a year, is it looks like some of the special interests have prevailed rather than the actual interest in the county, and therefore you're going to wind up with a county that's got this hodgepodge rather than something that's in the best interest of the county rather than in the best interest of a few individuals.
You're right, and I struggle with that all the time.
Yeah. And that's what I'm trying to do. I'd like to get everything on
part or the no growth part. You know, you can't lean to either side. You've got to look at how do you create a whole community.
That's right.
And that's what we need is a whole community. Mm-hmm.
So the county doesn't have a master plan?
Well, we do. I don't want to say that we don't. I mean, we have a comp plan, and we have a master plan, and we go through the motions.
But it's been updated and changed for you.
All counties.
You know, I've been here 40 years. My ex-husband started the first development authority here, industrial development authority. So I have watched the anti-growth people. I have watched, and you know, he always was pushing you must have balanced growth because your commercial and your industrial will bring a greater tax base to the county than your bedroom community. And a bedroom community always ends up having higher property taxes.
Very high taxes.
And I mean, that was what
to be like they're going to the hotel. They want all of the amenities, but we don't have the businesses to pay for it. You know, retail is a good thing. The best thing is I just helped a company that's here that's an injection molding company. Their equipment, each machine is about a $2 million machine, and they're adding four more machines. That is four machines, two people a shift, so that's eight. It's 24 employees, which is good, but there's not a whole lot of traffic associated. Those 24 people, every 8 hours, they rotate. But the ad valorem tax on that equipment is very high. So there's very low demand for services, but good ad valorem taxes. And that's the kind of stuff we need to look for.
I know I was active in helping pass some Freeport.
Freeport attention.
We still have that, right?
Absolutely.
In a more perfect world, we've got, you know, if you've got 10,000 residents out here in a district, we may have 11,000 opinions of what we want. And you say it's not your job to impress planning upon them. It's not his job to tell them what they should do. But what is the force that should get people together and say, look, you people are just dysfunctional.
You're running
wild. Get your head together, have some seminars, have some classes.
Well,
who does that?
Well, when I said that, I'll back up a little bit. It's not my job to come in and tell you what to do with your property.
But you could come and tell me what my choices are.
Well, I could, or we could say, here's an overall vision for this area of the county. That's what I've started doing with the community nodes, is to start bringing those communities back closer together so that we do allow retail and things at Wallace Tatum and Three. I'm talking about my north end. I don't know all the other areas of the county that well, but Wallace Tatum and 369, jot them down, and P. Ridge, not P. Ridge. Can't remember the name of the road now. Anyway, we didn't used to really want retail in those areas, but now we're going to encourage by having these zones where areas like that can prosper.
What do you think about incorporating some of those areas into cities, and rather than having
be
one
totally
city
dysfunctional? Look at Gwinnett County over there, and they've got cities that are suing the county on service delivery and all. We're so fortunate that it may not be perfect, but we're pretty fortunate. More cities would just be more bureaucracy and more headaches and more fight for the dollar and more fight for prestige and egos and all that. We don't need that.
More taxes.
I'm not pushing that.
No.
I was just asking you what your opinion.
Townships were floated a couple of years ago through the legislature, which would have created some additional zoning controls. Mm-hmm. I struggle with more government, more layers that people have to go through.
But I'm willing to, just like this gentleman was saying, I'm more than willing to speak with you in the fourth district and try to help you all accomplish what you want to accomplish. But at the same time, we've got to keep it in the best interest of the county, not necessarily in the best interest of each individual property owner.
No, we don't want that. And you're right. I mean, we can't allow certain uses in certain areas. I'm not suggesting that it be a free-for-all. And yes, through the comp plan process and the future development map and the character area map, we're setting the tone for what goes in certain areas. I wish the Planning Commission had a more active role in planning. I have said for a long time that they're a zoning commission.
I'm ready.
They hear zoning appeals, they hear zoning amendments, they hear all zoning, but they don't really spend a whole lot of time looking at the community. We got a 2030 that was done 5 years ago now. Now that's a great tool that we ought to be using. We've got our market study that tells us, we spent a lot of money on that. I think we contributed $30,000 to tell us what businesses we should be recruiting to our area based on our skill level of our citizens and the transportation that we can offer. We've got all these tools. We've just not put them all together.
Yeah.
And it's
a sad thing. So we can't go for the types of industries that need rail. We do have a planning department who have educated people who make the recommendations to the planning and zoning. At least that was when I was active in developing.
Yes and no, but they're more technical on things comply with UDC, for example.
But I thought we used to send them to ULI and to some of the...
Vincent, we don't do a whole lot of that anymore with no money.
Okay. At one time, I felt like our planning department had qualified people in there and that they really sat down with a lot of, because I've been a developer too, sat down with a lot of the developers and gave you options and made recommendations you could do.
They do based on the zoning of property, what the allowable zoning is, what likely could happen if you're rezoned to neighborhood shopping or 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 something, office and things like that, what you can do in those areas. That they do. But as far as looking at the overall picture of the community and developing a strategy that has no impact today or tomorrow, or maybe even 2 or 3 years from now, but it's a 15 to 25 year plan. We just don't have it.
So did I hear you say that you're willing to let the Planning Commission have a little bit more authority?
I don't say authority, Jody, but it's more doing what a planning commission should do.
Because our leadership in the planning commission doesn't let us do anything.
Well, it depends on how often people want to meet, how long the meetings can go, and, you know, that's a whole different animal.
No, I mean, if I've heard this is a recommending body only, and that's all we're going to do, I've heard that 1,000 times. We could be a lot more active and a lot more helpful and take a lot of pressure off of the Board of Commissioners, but I can't even get it past our leadership on the Planning Commission. I mean, it's just like,
well, I don't know.
Be quiet over there.
What?
So if you could help us.
What specific authority you would like, but I'm
going to. Well, I'm not saying authority.
What I'm looking at is we have the Quality of Life Council that the Chamber has the group that looks at all aspects of the community. We had the Vision 2030. All of those things are out there that we really should have some type of long-term a picture of what the community will look like in 15, 25, and 50 years. You know, what do we want it to look like?
Let me invite you to the Planning Commission and
y'all fight
and give us a talk on it.
Y'all fight too much. Y'all fight more than we do. But I do believe that. I'm not just saying that. I believe that the Planning Commission really should be looking at some of those things and taking some of the work session time.
I appreciate it. Well, whatever influence you can bring to bear on
some of the commission
members that would help.
Yeah.
I would appreciate it, and then we could work together a little bit closer on that.
Well, if we look at what is the Planning Commission, I've got the book. Everybody's got the book. We know and part of that, let me be fair, is this county grew so fast that there probably was no time for the Planning Commission to be anything but a zoning commission. We talked about from 2002 to 2005, 2006.
But we've got time now.
Plenty of time now. We got more time we don't do with.
But that's why I'm reaching out, saying, you know, we're here to help you guys. You know,
well, it's not really helping us, though. It's really, you know, one of the things I feel very strongly about is everybody says you're a community leader, and I'm really not. I'm a community representative for the mm-hmm. people that elect me. And really it's to bring their concerns and their ideas to the decision-making process. Mm-hmm. That's really what we're talking about in the planning process is taking the vision of the large landowners, mm-hmm. the people that have moved into the south end of the county that have different ideas and they like overlays and all that, but to bring all that together. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's not what we think that they ought to have as a good community. It's really what they feel is a good community, and then how do we put that together mm-hmm. into a plan that's achievable?
And I agree. That's why I'm saying, give us information. We're listening. I am for sure.
A lot of complaints that we get too are that people, the south end of the county, gets far more growth, development, and money and resources than the north end of the county.
They do. They do. And somebody was criticizing me about that the north end didn't get anything at SPLOST. We only got 2.7%. I don't know if that percentage is accurate, but the real it is a fact that more money goes to the south end of the county. But that's because they need more. They need more transportation improvements than we do in the north end. We don't need roads four lanes yet. We don't need intersections signalized with turn lanes and all that. They need it down there. Now you say, well, why do they need it? And we could use it if we want to bring businesses to the community. That's where the people are living. It's just a fact of the matter. And if we don't have good transportation in place, they're not going to bring businesses, which is going to impact the north end of the county by having high property taxes if we're not able to bring businesses. We've got to shift the resources to where they're needed. We do have a new fire station in Silver City. We're going to start one on Wallace Tail. We just started broke ground Friday in Ducktown. We have intersection improvements going on.
Oh, speaking of intersection improvements, what was the thought by that circle that's at
that was planned before I got here.
tell me what the rationale is. I can't believe you spent money on that.
I'm actually,
you're talking about
I've requested
Highway 9 and Joggingtown.
Yes. No, that's at Hopewell.
Hopewell and Joggingtown.
Yeah, Hopewell.
And I've asked for, I asked our director of engineering and his assistant who handles roads and bridges why we did a roundabout.
Allegedly, what did that cost?
$260,000. $263,000.
Waste of money.
Well, I don't know, and I'm waiting on, you know, I'm not a traffic engineer, but I'm waiting on some reports that
they're
getting.
But you go up there during the night and you're trying to drive that thing, they've got that fancy brick so far, and you've got very little room to drive.
The bricks
really
are driving
dangerous.
On it, actually. Do you know that? I didn't know that. Well, anyway, that was planned before I got here.
Yeah.
I have asked them to paint it.
So that you have reflectors or something.
Why did we do a roundabout versus a standard intersection? Mm-hmm. And I'm waiting to get that. And I'll start to send it out.
Is that the policy now, roundabouts?
Well, again, you know, we're always trying to make things better. And that's not just we county, it's we schools, we this. Everybody's always trying to improve. And the thought
well, I know there's studies nationwide.
That traffic moves easier and quicker through them and it's safer than intersections. And but I'm waiting on the proof. I don't have it yet. Let me see if, hang on.
Now, I was, you know, I carefully followed when we did the 2020 plan, and I did not carefully follow when we did the, and know very little about the 2030 plan, but what I was totally aghast about was when they did 2020, everything was so short-sighted because they didn't even look at an age factor. They did not address in the 2020 plan anything about the number of seniors we would have in our county.
We're still.
You know, and because that's baby boomers are the fastest growing part.
Yeah, there's been a big, I don't know what you want to call it, about a project down on Windermere Parkway. Help me, Jody, what's it called? List Hanson.
The one with the HUD thing.
Is it a senior?
Yeah, but the only problem with that is. You get the federal government involved, you know.
Oh, but is that what you were talking about, senior living?
Yes, I'm talking about overall. I mean, you have rich seniors and poor seniors, and you have to address the needs of
everybody. But you see, we've got a community that continues to say we don't want apartments. And we say, well, they're not apartments.
Yeah.
They're senior living, and they're not going to live in homes. They're going to live in these apartments, if you will. But they're not apartments.
To help you out on that, I think the people are... It's not so much over there on Windermere, it's not so much the accommodations, because my understanding is they're going to be very nice. It's where the money's coming from and the precedent that's being set, and it's never been done before.
Well,
but to answer
where they go, for one reason or another, they get fought.
Yeah, but I want to help you out on answering one of Carol's. It seems like most of the big projects that we've done over the past year have been related to seniors that have come through.
Well, that's about the only market that's still viable.
Uh-huh,
that's,
so to answer your question, I think that the commission...
But I'm not talking just about living and whatever, which is very important, but I'm talking about the seniors' needs, about, you know, getting food to them and the, you know, growth
well,
of plants.
Well, when
you come
to that, you know, that's kind of like, you know, what can we do for the community? I'm not sure, I'm not convinced, that I believe it's government's job to do that.
Yeah.
And I know that's difficult. Hold on a minute. You know, I was at church Sunday, I'm a trustee. There.
You're speaking to Democrats,
and,
man.
Well, I know we are, but you know, I'm still me.
Be careful.
I'm still me. And, you know, I believe that that is the place of churches, and I believe it's the place of civic organizations. And I'm very compassionate. I give a lot of money away. Not that I have that much, but comparatively speaking, I do. I donate a lot. I believe that's the place of the churches.
But I have worked on projects where Catholic Church has been turned down to do senior projects that were going to be low income. And the planning, the board is
turning. Are you talking about housing, or are you talking about food?
I'm talking about a planned unit development. It was going to be a crop.
Well, that's because we've had this fear, and density has been such a bad word around here. And we've got to change that attitude.
Because seniors can't live in a house and mow lawns.
They don't want it. They can't, and they don't want it.
Can I comment on that? Because mm-hmm. Next week, we're going to have hell raising at my house on this topic, I think. My children are coming to see me. And my wife has cancer, and they're telling me, Dad, get out of that house and move into proper housing. And so I look around. There are some very nice little condo units around, the orchards and places like that. Okay, I could buy one of those. But when it gets to the point where I can't drive anymore, can I walk to the grocery store? No, it's 3 miles.
Well,
there's one over here east of town that's right across the street from a public store. I could buy there, but I don't know if that public store will stay there as long as I do. They pick up and go, and so this is a bad market, we're building somewhere else.
Hopefully those prices.
So government gets involved there. Government shouldn't, I'm with you, shouldn't be funding all of the help.
But in the planning process.
But in the planning process.
In the planning process, we're trying to do that.
That's what I'm saying. We got to plan for a whole community.
I tried my hand at being a realtor. And the guy I was working for, and I was a total failure, the guy I was working for was working night and day. He had a piece of land up there, and he was going to build a housing unit for seniors up on Hopewell Road in the middle of the boonies.
That place is...
How in the world do you get to the doctor's office? How do you get to the hospital?
I tell you, they just built one on Jot 'em Down and 400.
So there's...
It is full.
So that goes back to my earlier question.
They provide transportation.
Who does the sell job? Who does the... Let's create a vision and let's sell it.
Well, one of the things I have asked about in this comp plan, and you'll see when it comes, hopefully we can get it, it may not be this time around, is a zoning designation for senior living. So that we can try to start identifying places that make sense, near the hospital, some of that land down there. But again, it doesn't matter. It could be out in the middle of the boonies because the owner operator might decide to have transportation to take people. So that's...
But I mean, I want to say that we're not the only county, because I've been working recently with a couple.
Georgia
is
terrible.
He's 88, she's 92. She's in a wheelchair, and I'm trying to find them, and they live in Gwinnett County, and I brought them over here because they needed to be near a hospital and near shopping, and there was nothing in Sugar Hill. There was nothing in Beaufort. You know, well, we're not the only one that's here.
Yeah, I don't agree with Carol. I really think, and for this gentleman here, Forsyth County is doing as well or better than most anybody as far as addressing citizens. As a matter of fact, we have an influx of senior citizens coming in, and they were asking us, and we were taking that into account, to have low cost senior housing, you know, because not everybody can afford the orchard or whatever. But just to assure people, you know, we were on the steering committee that those things are kind of in the works, but right now, you know, the thing that's in the forefront of everybody's mind is the jail, you know, and. Of course, I have my own feelings about that.
They've got funding and they're starting, and it's a great facility.
It's one of the markets that's still
from on. From a community standpoint and a government standpoint, the best thing we could do is assist people with creating, I hate to bring it up, at the golf course. They want to build cottages to assisted living, to Alzheimer's, to hospice. Now, the golf course...
The only problem I have with that is I developed the subdivision that was
there. No, but I'm just saying... But that's
really
a,
hurts.
Well, no, but I'm saying
that.
Just for that area, just for that development. Those are the type of developments we need to encourage. I'm not saying the golf course. I'm saying that type of development where somebody can move into a cottage. It's a two- or three-bedroom cottage. It's a rental cottage. So we're getting full taxes on it. You're not getting your exemption. So we get full taxes with very little services. You have no kids in school. You don't go out every day, two and three times a day. You know, people my age, we're coming and going all day long. We come to work. It's horrendous. We're hard on the community. So rental. Then you migrate to the assisted living, which is like an apartment where there's nurses there. If you need them, they're there. But if they leave you alone, to the more of a nursing home type of environment, to hospice.
It's a continuum, but we need those type of developments.
But you're talking about
We don't embrace them because of the density.
And it's wrong. We have a fabulous now hospital. I mean, 30 years ago, we didn't have a hospital.
We
now have really a top-rate hospital.
I'm not saying that we need increased density, but we need to quit using density as a deciding factor. We need to look at all the factors and make a decision, and not just because it's dense. Because dense cottages are great for the community with seniors.
If it's a good project, it's a good project.
Absolutely.
But if nobody really, the problem we have is not that people are so much against growth, it's just that we don't do any planning. So when growth happens, it happens in the worst possible way. we have a poor, we have a very poor record. You can just drive on any street around here at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and you'll have all the evidence you need as to where the worst planning took place.
Well, part of that is again market driven. We were not, you know, I grew up in Florida. I grew up in Jacksonville. I moved here in 99, and Palm Coast was just south of us, and that was a community that was planned. And we're not that.
Not the entire community.
The villages.
No, what I'm talking about is when you look at, go out, drive out Castleberry Road from Highway 9, go up towards town, okay? And you'll look on all, you'll see all kinds of subdivisions that are already there. And you'll see more subdivisions in the near future. But all that does is create other stresses on our infrastructure, our schools, our transportation, our police, and our fire. And we don't need all that, and on our water and sewers.
So but you say we don't need it because people are buying those homes.
That's what I'm saying, because we don't have any planning. It's what we're doing is we're living at the mercy of, we live at the mercy of speculators, land speculators. And that's why they want to control the commissioners. And that's why they want to touch your planning meetings, your zoning meetings out. They just want to do away with those. They don't want you there. That's why they
want. You think I don't know that?
Yeah, I know. That's why they compress your
time. That's
what I'm talking about.
Well, that's a tough thing to say, because people are not going to invest millions of dollars where they're not going to get a return on their investment. They're not just building a subdivision.
If you guide it, you can guide it. You can go, you can develop, you can have your high density, but you got to keep it in one area. You can't just have high density here and then go 10 miles down the road and have another high density, or 3 miles down the road and have another. You got to contain it, you got to manage it properly, so that you, we don't do much farming in this county anymore.
No, we do a lot of chicken.
I know, but see, we should be able to still raise some of our own food in this area and not be so reliant on Publix bringing in food from California or Florida. We could still do
developers that. Do care.
I didn't say they care, they're chasing the dollar though.
And that's the difference. I still haven't reconciled since coming here from the Midwest. In the Midwest, when a builder built something, his name was out there. People will build a house next door to you today, and in Georgia, nobody puts a name out front. This house being built by Tom Jones.
No.
Up north, Tom Jones wanted you to know, look at this fine house. If you want to call
it corporate.
Well, generally it's by a corporation.
But even corporations up there. But I work for a builder developer. And the last thing we wanted was a reputation that every neighborhood they've ever built turned into a trash or turned into a busy place. You know, every development that guy has developed in the last 20 years, you can get in and out of there. We go see friends. We go play bridge over there. You can get in and out. I want to buy a house in his development. I don't see that happening here like it did there.
Let's just take a minute. It's just after 8, and I was told that y'all had business meeting, and I don't mind saying, I'll stay all night, it doesn't matter to me. Is there other issues besides development that there's questions about?
I have a question that's totally unrelated to what we've been talking about, and maybe it's not even a question, but you'll probably give me some background for it. Mm-hmm. And I know it's been quite a while since this happened, but I haven't seen any of you to really bring it up. The county manager got a 22% raise at a time when the employees have been absolutely suffering, not getting paid for, I think, 7 out of 10 holidays that they used to get paid for, taking an 18% cut in pay on top of that, I believe. Okay, at any rate. But at any rate, they have had a lot of cuts. And then the county commissioners go, oh yeah, Doug, you can have a 22% increase. And I was absolutely appalled. You know, Patrick, my background is in organization development and psychology, working with public sector quite a bit, as well as the corporate side. But that is the biggest morale decreaser that you can absolutely do.
It came from... It was well intentioned.
I'm sure it was well intentioned. Yeah.
You know, we look back, and especially myself, I look back at the managers that we've had in this county, and I'm not saying that any of them have been bad, but we've had some instability. Mm-hmm. We've had instability in the financial arena. Mm-hmm. And when our last county manager left, and Doug stepped in to that position, he worked harder than I've ever seen anybody work. Private sector or not, he worked harder than self-employed people. I'm self-employed and I work. Mm-hmm. I'll go home and work tonight. Mm-hmm. He was doing that. He was in that building until 11 or 12 o'clock at night. Mm-hmm. We looked at what We had been paying our county manager, that was a rate that had been established some time ago, and felt that he was due a raise. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a faux pas, because mm-hmm. our staff has not had a raise in 3 years at that point.
Right.
And it was something that was needed here, but was bad over here.
Right.
I have no, I mean, that's the fact of the matter. I'm happy we did it. He's the most, he has brought such a tremendous amount of stability.
I think Doug is
and we didn't
capable.
Want to risk losing that stability. Because,
right.
you know, word gets out. There's 159 counties, and, mm-hmm. and we are all out talking to other commissioners, mm-hmm. and word gets out. And we didn't want to risk losing somebody that has brought a tremendous amount of value to the taxpayers.
Right. But you're right about the timing, though, and that's
bad
the thing.
Timing.
Really
bad timing.
Bad timing.
Absolutely.
And it really did a lot of damage. And
it did.
You're probably still going to be having repercussions from that.
Well, hopefully that we've shown our employees, you know, we have tried to protect. They've had no cuts. We really went, we didn't furlough like a lot of mm-hmm. counties. Mm-hmm. We had no reduction in pay. We
this time?
We've never reduced pay. Never.
That's we've not what I understand.
They've not gotten cost of living increases. But there's mm-hmm. never been a cut in pay. Mm. No.
Okay.
No. Absolutely not.
Except for not getting paid for those holidays, which...
Exactly. They didn't get them. Now, I will tell you that I wanted to pay them for the same holidays that people in the corporate world got.
Mm-hmm.
Not government world, the corporate world.
Mm-hmm.
And we brought that back this year. You know, I've always struggled with why do government employees get paid for Veterans Day more, you know, not President's Day, and all these mm-hmm. days that they're off. You know, I believe they ought to be paid the same as they would be in the corporate arena.
Yeah.
So that's the
But when
six.
You say we've done it already, it hasn't taken effect yet,
it will
right?
next year.
2012. It will next year.
They get their okay. holidays back. They got seven holidays back.
Okay.
They got a 3% cost of living. No increase okay. in health care premiums. But we did supplement that by tobacco users pay a 50% surcharge.
Mm-hmm.
Which we started 2 years ago, and I have no problem with accountability-based premiums.
Mm-hmm.
If you smoke, you need to pay more,
right.
Or tobacco use, really.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, we've brought that all that back. I can't tell you how proud I am. As Jody said, you know, we've worked hard, and it's not just this board. It's you know, Commissioner Harrell and I were on the Finance Committee together.
Mm-hmm.
And when you saw us in meetings, you might think we didn't like each other. Well, we probably didn't really like each other a whole lot, but we worked very well together on the Finance Committee,
mm-hmm.
very well together.
Okay.
We got a lot done, and I'm proud of that.
Thank you.
And to answer your other question, I'm proud of what the commission did with Doug Dare. I understand your concern about the timing, but
poor timing.
Well, it wasn't poor timing. It was, you didn't pick the timing. You didn't pick the timing. He was here, and it was time to, I mean, he had to be compensated.
Contractually,
and I mean, if you had put it off, he might not have been here much longer. And I think it was the right thing to do for that particular person and for the county. But I'm very sensitive to the, I've talked to my own commissioner about being sensitive to the employees, mm-hmm. and they're,
but I hear what you're saying, but I cannot agree with you at all.
Huh?
I hear what you're saying, and I cannot agree with you at all.
Okay, well, that's fine.
Yeah.
But one other thing that I wanted to bring up was, Commissioner Bell is going to be seeing this, that one thing that's going to be talked about, I believe, in the future, I hope y'all talk about it, is the number of county employees that are really not working. And you know what I'm talking about. And I think y'all are getting ready to look at that seriously, and I think that's very responsible.
Well, we periodically do a survey. We did it four years ago. The year before I came on the board, they did a study of all the departments, and
yeah.
it's time to update that again.
But I don't know
who does those studies, Patrick?
But that's on with I'm sorry, your name is or
Risha.
That's another side of the taking somebody who's working real hard, you know, and giving a raise, and then you got to identify these people. You don't want to give somebody a raise just because they're a government employee, particularly if they're sitting out there reading a book all day, you know.
Right, but these are the kinds of things I've worked with for 30 years, so I understand the process, and I understand...
Our study was done by the Carl Benson Institute at the University of Georgia.
Okay. So do they have human...
It was poor time. With this particular raise. Now, you know, as Jody said, it was time, contractually. You know, it just happened to fall...
At a bad time.
Part of that contract was to do a salary survey, which we didn't pay for a survey. We had somebody gather information from other counties around the state. And part of that contract was to do a wage survey and adjust it accordingly.
Right.
Would Doug have would he have taken less? Probably so. I don't want anybody to think that he was saying, you know, give me a raise, I'm walking, because he's not that kind of guy. He's a tremendous manager.
No.
But, you know, I'm intimately aware of how much good he's done for this community. I mean, he has created a stable government like we've not had in decades.
That's great.
He is an organizer. You know, you're a corporate organizer. It's probably that word.
It's organization. No.
I'm sorry.
Organizational psychology.
Okay, well, and that's what he did. He came in
with an emphasis in human resources, which is really where that's coming from.
So, and that's what he did. He is organized. I mean, he went through each department and worked with the directors on who was doing what, where, and how, and overlap. And I mean, he really has done a lot of work.
I have one or two things I want to touch base on the roundabout you're talking about. I personally think roundabouts are great. I don't know how it ended up over there. You know, that was kind of before me too. But my understanding, I think Roswell put in a roundabout, and the state of Georgia, correct me if I'm wrong, you can get like 2-for-1. Is that right? I mean, you can pay for one, and the state will give you another. And that's a pretty good deal. And I think that roundabouts ought to be the future. But the problem is going to be trying to get people who are not used to roundabouts to drive in them. I understand that. But I'm a big supporter. One of the biggest places, I think, in Forsyth County that happens to be in the city up there across the street from Mr. Swiss. That, to me, I think that would be a great place for a roundabout, but that's the city, and that has nothing to do with what we're doing here.
Yeah, and to go up there at night and drive through it, and all of a sudden you're hit by this. You have no idea what's... Maybe we need some lights. You need to paint the edges. If that was there and had reflectors, you'd be okay.
What about a sign that says roundabout ahead? Would that help? But
that wouldn't help as much as a sign.
It's pitch black. I mean, you got
the little spokes that show which is highway if you want to get off.
I'll take that back and mention it to them.
Because it makes a big difference, especially the seniors. Even though I've got my cataracts fixed, it's hard to drive.
Especially on nights like tonight.
And it's very dangerous.
And the other thing I see on spending money and taking care of the employees, which I think is very important to have. I mean, I was in private enterprise for a while, and I always tried to take real good care of my employees. It was a selfish motive, because if I took good care of them, they really took good care of me, and it worked. And so I'm all for the county doing everything they can to take as good a care of the employees and pay them good so that they will perform. They will respond
private enterprise
to that.
But you're paying your employees, and you're spending your money.
The amount of money that it would take to get our employees happy and maybe even get rid of some of the ones that are not happy is, in my opinion, is not much compared to the amount of money that we overpay developers or for property that could be bought elsewhere and stuff at a cheaper price. I mean, the markup that the county ends up paying on some of this property that I think it is kind of out of line. And you can save a lot of money from that. I know you would disagree with that, but.
Well, there's probably a couple of parcels that have some questions about them. Every piece that I've been involved with since before I came on the board, after I got elected in November of 2008, I got to sit in on executive sessions. And I of course sit at home now. Every piece of property that we've bought, we have an appraisal done. And we will not pay, well, the policy of the board has always been not to pay more than 15% more than appraised value. I don't know where that came from.
Is that gonna happen downtown on the jail property? Because the appraised value, I'm gonna say.
I don't have those numbers in my head, but we're probably.
You and I both know that that's not gonna happen on that.
Oh, I bet it is.
But on the
one of them bought for $300,000 below appraised value.
Talking about planning, I think it's really bad planning to put a whole bunch of rental condominiums where the golf course is. The roads around there are not going to support it, and people down the road, somebody's going to look at me and say, Jody Moses, that was bad planning to put that in there, and I'm going to say, I think you're right, so there's something that hasn't happened yet.
Do you think that it's proper for government to tell somebody they have to be in the golf business?
Huh?
Do you think it's proper?
I think it's proper for zoning to be done.
People that would have kept it as a golf course, and they have turned it down because they
the
have.
That's capitalism, though. You know, he can make more money doing this.
Yeah, of course,
I've been in court for both sides. That's speculating.
Speculators and developers are the primary cause of corruption in county government.
Planning is trying to keep these developers and speculators under control. And the planning department needs help with that. And that's what's going on with the golf course. Just talking about, you answered the guy's question about, well, we're going to have all this stuff right here. You can move around. Guess what? You can go and buy a cheaper piece of property and put everything in a different spot. Not only would it, you could still have that beautiful golf course there, which would be an asset to the county, but you could put the people in a different spot.
But if the guy that owns the golf course doesn't want a golf course, it's not government's job to tell him he has to keep the golf course.
It's not the government's job to give him a tarp bailout either.
No tarp bailout, didn't cost us anything, except that we spent $500,000 on legal fees trying to force him to keep his golf course.
Well, anyway, I'm trying to address it from the planning standpoint where I'm hearing some people say, there's poor planning. We try to plan, but
that golf course was part of a master plan.
It absolutely was.
Yeah, because I was involved in 73.
It was part of a huge master plan development that went broke and was busted up.
That's
unfortunate, but it happened.
Yeah. But when Jack bought it, Mr. Rockmore told Jack that he was to keep it as a golf course, because I was there when it happened.
That'd be somebody selling me a car and telling me I got to keep it red. I'm not going to keep it red if I don't want it red.
And there's some things that will never get settled in one night.
No. And that's, we were just talking beforehand. If you have a meeting where everybody's agreeing, you're not having a good meeting. That's right.
Can I ask one easy question?
You sure can.
It has nothing to do with people or planning. Are we moving forward on an animal shelter?
We are.
Okay.
When that issue came up in December of last year, I guess it was. I did not believe that awarding a proposal to a company for $2 million with no study, with no looking at what we needed, was appropriate. So we put the committee together, which has Dr. Magruder, Todd Levent, Lance White, I don't know everybody that's on it, they have gone to Gwinnett County, they've gone to Hall County, they've gone to Dawson County, they've gone to Cherokee County. They have studied and talked, and yeah, it's going to cost us a little bit more money, but it's going to be a more usable facility. And I think it's going to have some of the stuff that I don't necessarily think we need, but I think the community believes we need it, so I'll support it. You know, I didn't support the green space bond. I was one of the 15% that didn't vote for it. 85% did, so my job's to carry it out well. So I'll do that with animal shelter, it will move forward.
I think the general feeling, commissioners, there's a big population growth in this county, and it's time to
We've got to do something, but we've got to do education more than just taking care of people's animals.
There's always another need. But yep. Someone has to step up.
That was put on a priority A in SPLOST. And it will be financed to go ahead and get it started, probably through the Public Facilities Authority, which is an authority that was created. It's a government authority that was created by the state that has the ability to borrow money for public facilities. So that's where that will come from. It will move forward. And it'll move forward equally as fast as the jail and the courthouse. Those three projects will move forward.
Well, thank you so much. We really appreciate
it. Thank you for having me.
And I just wanted to make two quick comments. Mm-hmm. Actually, the seniors are not the fastest growing population in the country, or in any section of this country. The disabled population is. Mm-hmm. And if you look on every census record, the disabled population is beating any other population three times.
I can believe that now, because I was at the VA this morning.
And the other thing that I was going to mention is, I had mentioned this to Mr. Tan when he invited me for coffee. We really need to, we've got shelters for animals, we've got shelters for people of abuse, we've got shelters for drug problems, we need shelters for people that are homeless.
We do.
You know, there's a tent city within throwing distance.
Right over there.
Yeah.
There is, and that's, again, not to get off on another tangent and drag the meeting out, that's one of those things that we really have to get our community involved. The government can't solve it. We can throw money at it, but we can't solve it.
No.
Our church, as I was saying, we had a planning meeting Saturday, we had a trustees meeting on Sunday, and we struggle with how do we help the community more. Churches are struggling with donations being down, you know, ways struggling. Everybody's struggling. I don't know the answer. I don't think any of us know the answer.
No, but
you know, from a government's perspective, we can certainly streamline things, make it easier and quicker for those that have the funds to help. I'm not sure that we need to use taxpayer money to help, but we could certainly.
We need to be addressing it somehow.
You're not kidding.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
You too.
We're a political organization, and if we required news to vote, we would be having a poll back, and that's illegal.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll stay.
Glad you came back.